Aunt Eulalia, Chapter 3. All glories to Sri Krishna Chaitanya, who possesses all transcendental qualities. He is the life and soul of Nityananda Prabhu and Swarup Damodar Prabhu. He is the supreme actor of Vaikuntha and an ocean of compassion. He is the jewel amongst sannyasis and the true friend of the destitute. Please listen attentively to the narration of Lord Chaitanya's pastimes recorded in the Antya Leela. They are concentrated nectar, which Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma are always hankering to relish. These pastimes, when heard with proper faith, are a source of intense spiritual pleasure for everyone except the sinful miscreants. One who hears these esoteric subjects will certainly attain the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. It is described in this chapter how the Lord concealed his real identity. When the Supreme Lord decides to remain incognito, who can recognize him? One day, while sitting with Sarvabhauma in a secluded place, the Lord said to him, "O respected sir, I want to open my heart to you. Although I have come to Puri to see Lord Jagannath, my main reason for coming was to meet you. Lord Jagannath is not going to speak with me, but you can sever the bonds of my material attachments. Lord Krishna has fully empowered you to distribute the love of Godhead. If you want, you can give it to me also. Therefore, I am taking shelter of you. Kindly do what is most beneficial for me. What must I do and how must I act in order to keep from falling into the deep dark well of material existence? Please advise and guide me in every way. I have surrendered myself unto you." In this way, the Lord spoke to Sarvabhauma, deluding him completely. Sarvabhauma could not fathom the Lord's words and intentions. He began to explain to him the religious duties of man. He said, "I appreciate everything you have said. You have reached lofty heights of devotional realization. You have indeed been blessed by Krishna. But I am curious to know what prompted an intelligent person like you to enter the renounced order of life. Please try to analyze the results of taking sannyas. The first thing that happens is that one is immediately attacked by pride. Holding the sannyas danda, he thinks he is empowered with special knowledge, and no longer folds his hands or bows his head to anyone. When he meets a saintly person, who, according to the Vedas, is to be worshipped by smearing the dust from his lotus feet on one's head, the sannyasi simply offers respect to him superficially, not feeling any genuine reverence. This sort of arrogance is unhealthy. Try to understand this point by considering this verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The Supreme Lord has entered every living entity as the soul, his part and parcel. Knowing this, one should offer his dandavat obeisances even to a dog-eater, dog, cow, ass, and all other beings. This is the proper standard of behavior for a Vaishnava. Only a charlatan devotee will act otherwise. The only things one accomplishes by taking sannyas are shaving off one's sika and receiving respect and honor from many people. The next disaster is that one loses all good sense. The living entity is meant to worship and serve the Supreme Lord, but instead, the sannyasi calls himself Narayan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When the human soul is in the womb of a mother, in the form of a fetus, the Supreme Lord comes to his rescue. At that time, by the grace of the Lord, the living entity receives proper knowledge and intelligence. Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, Anantashesh, and Lakshmi Devi are all trying to serve that same Supreme Personality. In fact, even after being engaged in his service, they hanker for more. The creation, maintenance, and annihilation of the entire cosmos are carried out by the servants of that same Supreme Person, yet the sannyasi is not ashamed to call himself Prabhu or Lord. When lost in deep sleep, he does not even remember who he is. Yet when awake, he shamelessly thinks that he is Narayan, the Supreme Godhead. The Vedic literature declares that Lord Krishna is the Supreme Father of the entire creation. One who serves and obeys the Father is a good son. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna states, "I am the Father of this universe, the Mother, the Support, and the Grandsire." Now listen to what the Supreme Lord Narayan himself tells Arjuna about sannyas in the Gita. "One who is unattached to the fruits of his work and acts strictly according to scriptural injunctions is called a yogi or sannyasi. Not he who lights no sanctified fire and performs no work." It is stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam, One should act for the sole purpose of pleasing Lord Hari. One's education should be only to elevate one to Krishna consciousness. The Supreme Lord Hari is the super soul and guide of all living entities who have accepted material bodies. He is the supreme controller and cause of this material world. If after studying these scriptural references you argue that Sankaracharya is not of the same opinion, then I will quote something that he himself has said which indicates his desire to serve the Lord. He said, "O Lord, although Jiva and Brahman, the absolute truth, are qualitatively the same, I, a Jiva soul, am always under your control, and my existence depends entirely upon you and not vice versa. There is no qualitative difference between the ocean and its waves, but still the waves exist because of the ocean and not the other way around." The Supreme Lord Krishna is the Father, and this cosmic manifestation belongs to Him. He is the maintainer of both the material and spiritual realms. One who does not worship and serve the Father is to be ostracized. This is the essential meaning of Sankaracharya's words. Without understanding this, shaving one's head will only result in distress. A sannyasi should utter the name of Narayan incessantly with loving devotion. Without this devotional attitude, there is no use in becoming a renunciate. This is why I ask you why you have taken sannyas. If you want to deliver the world by distributing the science of devotional service to Lord Krishna, then why have you shaved off your sika and discarded your Brahmin thread? If you argue that spiritual stalwarts like Madhavendra Puri became mendicants and shaved their heads, I reply that you are not yet old enough to accept the renounced order. These stalwarts took sannyas only after 3/4 of their lives had passed and after they had sufficient experience of material life, whereas you have just entered your youth. How, therefore, can you justify taking sannyas? How can being in the renounced order help you advance in spiritual realization, considering the devotion I have seen you manifest? These ecstatic symptoms of love of Godhead are rarely experienced even by the great yogis. So why have you allowed yourself to be misled by illusion? Lord Chaitanya was very pleased to hear the science of devotional service explained by Sarvabhauma. He said, "O respected Sarvabhauma, please do not consider me to be a sannyasi. I have shaved my head, given up my Brahmin's thread, and left my home and family only because the pangs of separation from my beloved Krishna were becoming unbearable for me. Therefore, please do not think of me as a sannyasi, but rather be merciful to me so that I can develop attachment for Krishna." The Supreme Lord desired to put his dear devotee into illusion, so how could he know the truth? If the Lord does not reveal himself, then who is able to know him as he is? Still, the Lord is very pleased to hear his dear devotee speak, even without proper knowledge. The Lord is always engaged in performing pastimes with his servitors. In fact, he appears only for the pleasure of his devotees. He is always relishing devotional mellows with them. The Lord gives himself to a devotee according to the devotee's surrender to him. He is bhaktavatsal, which means that he always favors his devotees. Who can influence the Lord to act otherwise? Lord Chaitanya smiled at Sarvabhauma, but still under the spell of the Lord's illusory energy, Sarvabhauma failed to fully comprehend his words. He said, "Your status as a sannyasi is certainly more elevated than mine. According to scriptural injunctions, you are worshipable, and I am the worshiper. It is not logical that you should praise me. This might make me an offender." The Lord replied, "Please do not deceive me further in this manner. I have fully surrendered to you." In this way, the Supreme Lord, Gaurasundar, played with his servitors. Who can fathom the transcendental pastimes of the Lord? The Lord again spoke to Sarvabhauma, "I yearn to hear your explanations of the Srimad Bhagavatam. All the doubts that assail me can be allayed only by you." Sarvabhauma replied, "I am well aware that you have deep and mature understanding of all the scriptures. What in the Bhagavatam is unknown to you? Yet I realize that noble and cultured devotees always discuss amongst themselves the science of devotional service. Now please tell me which portion of the Bhagavatam confuses you, and I will try my best to explain it." The Lord of Vaikuntha, Sri Krishna Chaitanya, smiled quietly and recited a verse from the Bhagavatam. "Those who are self-satisfied and unattracted by external material desires are, on the other hand, attracted to the loving service of Sri Krishna, whose qualities are transcendental and whose activities are wonderful. Hari, the personality of Godhead, is called Krishna because he has such transcendentally attractive features." By the grace of the Lord, Sarvabhauma began his dissertation in the presence of Lord Gaurasundar, who is the Lord of the Goddess of Learning and Speech, Mother Saraswati. He explained, "The real meaning of this verse is as follows. The essence of all truth is loving devotional service at Krishna's lotus feet. Fully realized souls who are free from all hankering and attachments surrender to his lotus feet. Such is the extraordinary potency of Lord Krishna's transcendental qualities. These liberated souls constantly glorify his qualities and pastimes. Those who are ignorant of the Lord's transcendental nature are doomed to annihilation." Totally absorbed in the discourse he was giving, Sarvabhauma offered 13 different explanations of the verse. Finally, he fell silent, saying, "I am unable to go any further on this subject." The Lord smiled again and said, "Each one of your explanations is correct. Now I will give my explanation. Please judge whether or not it is correct." Sarvabhauma stared at the Lord in wonder. He said, "It is beyond the power of any human being to elucidate further on this subject." Nevertheless, the Lord expressed his realizations, which were original and had never before been expressed by anyone. Sarvabhauma, still in a state of shock, thought, "These words could have been spoken only by the Supreme Lord himself." After his discourse, the Lord, roaring like thunder, became absorbed in himself and manifested his wonderful six-armed form. He then asked Sarvabhauma, "What do you say now? Do you still think that I am unqualified to be a sannyasi? Do you not consider me a sannyasi in your heart? I have come here only to see you. You have spent many lifetimes in devoted service to me, so I am presenting myself personally to you. I have appeared specifically to inaugurate the Sankirtan movement. Know for certain that I am that Supreme Lord who is the cause of the entire cosmic manifestation. Since you have always been my unalloyed devotee, I have especially come to see you. My mission is to protect my devotees, the saintly souls, and to destroy the demoniac forces. Allay your fears now and glorify me." Seeing the Lord's wonderful six-armed form, which is more dazzling than a million suns, Sarvabhauma fell to the ground, overcome with ecstasy. The Supreme Lord Gaurachandra continued to roar loudly, still exhibiting his six-armed form. The Lord was very pleased with Sarvabhauma, and placing his hand on his head, the Lord said, "Arise." The divine touch on his head awakened Sarvabhauma, but paralyzed with intense joy, he could not speak. The Lord, an ocean of munificence, placed his lotus feet on Sarvabhauma's heart. Sarvabhauma, finding the most precious treasure within easy reach, tightly embraced the Lord's lotus feet. His heart overflowing with pure joy, Sarvabhauma said, "Today I have captured the thief who steals my heart." He broke down in tears, sobbing like a child. He had found a treasure sought after even by the goddess of fortune, Ramadevi. Words now poured from Sarvabhauma's mouth. "O Lord Krishna Chaitanya, you are the Lord of my life. Please look compassionately upon this worthless wretch. I am so sinful that I dared to try to teach you religious principles, not knowing that you are the transcendental cause of all causes. O Lord, even the most powerful mystic is mesmerized by your illusory potency. So it is not difficult to delude me. But now, my Lord, please grant me undeviating devotion to your lotus feet. All glories to Sri Krishna Chaitanya, the Lord of my heart. He has appeared from the womb of the Divine Mother, Sachi. He is the life and soul of everyone, and the protector of the Vedas, the Brahmins, the pious, and the religious principles. He is the supreme autocratic lord of all the planetary systems, including the spiritual planets of Vaikuntha. You possess an eternal form full of knowledge and bliss, and you are the invaluable crown which decorates the sannyas order." Having been endowed with transcendental intelligence, the saintly Sarvabhauma glorified the Lord with choice verses. He continued his eulogy, "May my heart, like a bumblebee, be strongly attracted to the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, who has appeared as Sri Krishna Chaitanya, to rejuvenate the path of devotional service to himself, which has become neglected and almost lost due to the passage of time. I take complete shelter of the unrivaled Supreme Absolute Lord. He is the cause of all causes and the most munificent personality. He has appeared as Sri Krishna Chaitanya to teach humanity the science of renunciation, knowledge, and devotion to himself." Sarvabhauma composed 100 sublime verses, as he clasped the Lord's lotus feet. He continued, "My Lord, you have appeared simply to liberate the fallen souls, so kindly deliver this wretch. Under the influence of your Maya potency, I have been bound up by the chains of material education, wealth, and high birth. How then can I know you as you really are? Thus I beg one favor from you, O Lord of the universe. May my mind and heart become totally engrossed in you, without deviating for even a minute. All of your activities are inconceivable and transcendental. Hence, they are incomprehensible to everyone unless you personally reveal them. You have accepted the transcendental wooden form of Lord Jagannath, and you are sitting in Nilachala, mercifully enjoying the foodstuffs offered by your devotees. Now, you personally offer foodstuffs, eat them yourself, and then distribute them to everyone as your mercy. Then you cry in separation upon seeing your own self, and mad with love you become attracted to your own form. How can anyone understand you at all? You alone know your real self, and others are able to know you only if they are blessed by your causeless mercy. How then can I, an insignificant entity, know you? Even Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, and other demigods fall victim to your powerful deluding potency, Maya." Suddenly eloquent by the mercy of the Lord, Sarvabhauma offered him many beautiful verses of praise. The Supreme Lord Gaurachandra, still manifesting his six-armed form, smiled benignly upon Sarvabhauma and said, "Dear Sarvabhauma, you are my eternal associate. Therefore, you are able to see my mystic opulences. I have come to this place only to meet you, because you have worshipped me for so long. Your explanations of devotional service have greatly pleased me. What you have spoken is the absolute truth. Anyone who hears or recites the 100 verses composed by you in glorification of me will develop undeviating devotion unto me. These verses will become famous as the Sarvabhauma Sataka, or Sarvabhauma's 100 verses. I forbid you to reveal to anyone that you have seen this form of mine, at least for as long as I am present on this earth. Nityananda Prabhu is very close to me, in fact, he is my second body. Serve his lotus feet with deep devotion. His identity is also an extremely esoteric subject, which can be known only if I disclose it." After confiding in Sarvabhauma, the Lord withdrew his mystic manifestation. As the truth about his Lord dawned upon him, Sarvabhauma became submerged in ecstasy. Anyone who hears these supra-mundane pastimes of the Lord is immediately liberated from material entanglement, and after death attains the personal abode of Lord Chaitanya. The topics of Lord Krishna's pastimes are very confidential. Hence, one is assured of the shelter of the Lord if one sincerely hears them. In this way, Lord Chaitanya liberated Sarvabhauma and introduced his Sankirtan movement in Nilachala. He performed continual kirtan and dancing there. Days and nights were submerged in a deluge of devotional nectar. The residents of Nilachala were offered the rare transcendental treat of this Sankirtan mood, and they responded by jubilantly singing Hari, Hari. Seeing Lord Gaurachandra, the people said, "Here is our moving Lord Jagannath." The Lord's glances mesmerized them. They forgot whatever they were doing. Wherever he went, he was always greeted with a resounding chanting of Hari, Hari. People threw themselves to the ground to bathe in the dust that bore the impression of his lotus feet. Only the most pious and fortunate were given this transcendental opportunity. It is impossible to describe the bliss experienced by them. The Lord's exquisite form attracted the minds of everyone. Who could resist such perfect beauty? His eyes were always decorated with cascades of tears of bliss and loving separation from his Lord. The holy name of Krishna was always on his tongue. His golden body, decorated with sandalwood paste and flower garlands, moved gracefully, making the movements of a mad elephant look awkward. Although he walked about in the streets, Lord Chaitanya, the Supreme Lord, was always deeply saturated with the sublime nectar of love of Godhead and was oblivious to the world. One day, Sri Paramananda Puri returned after a long tour pilgrimage to all. One day, Sri Paramananda Puri returned after a long tour of pilgrimage to all the holy places. Seeing him approaching from a distance, Lord Chaitanya hastily got up with great deference. The Supreme Lord Gaurachandra was extremely happy to see his devotee, and lifting his hands in the air, he began to dance, relishing this delectable moment of meeting his devotee after a long separation. He exclaimed, "Hari, Hari, my eyes have seen Sri Paramananda Puri. How fortunate is my birth, how blessed is my vision. All my religious practices have now become fruitful. Today, my acceptance of the sannyas order has become a success. Sripad Madhavendra Puri has appeared before me." He rushed to embrace his beloved devotee, and holding Paramananda Puri to his chest, the Lord bathed him with tears of divine ecstasy. Paramananda Puri, looking at the moon-like beatific face of his dear Lord, was overwhelmed with indescribable bliss. After a while, they offered obeisances to each other. Indeed, Paramananda Puri is the object of Lord Chaitanya's love. The Lord was pleased to recover his eternal servitor and kept him beside him as his associate. Paramananda Puri, having again found his beloved Lord, served his lotus feet with increasing ecstasy. Sri Paramananda Puri, who was expert in relishing devotional mellows, was a very dear disciple of Sripad Madhavendra Puri. A few days later, Swarup Damodar came and joined them. Swarup Damodar was so intimate with Lord Gaurasundar that they would spend many days and nights together in spiritual intimacy. Damodar was also a very versatile musician. His singing invariably inspired Lord Chaitanya to dance. This final portion of the book will deal extensively with the activities of Paramananda Puri and Swarup Damodar. Gradually, all the associates and servitors of the Lord began to come to Nilachala. Those associates who were born in Utkala, or modern Orissa, also came one by one to join him. Elevated souls like Pradyumna Mishra, who was always absorbed in love of God, and Paramananda and Ramananda came and joined the others. Damodar Pandit and Sri Shankar Pandit came shortly after. Pradyumna Brahmachari also came. He was a pure servant of Lord Nrisimhadev, who had manifested himself in his body. When he performed kirtan, he looked like Lord Nrisimha as a sannyasi. Bhagavanacharya, who, like a lotus, could remain unpolluted even in the midst of mundane discussions and association, also came to meet the Lord. On seeing their beloved Lord, the devotees were immediately free from all distress and joined him in singing and dancing. The Lord of Vaikuntha, who was now a sannyasi, danced with his associates in divine ecstasy. Lord Nityananda was always submerged in loving mellows with Lord Chaitanya, and this made him restless and caused him to act according to his own sweet will. Once he rushed toward the deity of Lord Jagannath, wanting to embrace him. Even the temple sentries could not check him. One day he jumped up on the golden altar and wrapped his arms around the deity of Lord Balaram. Seeing this, the sentry on duty rushed at him to bring him down from the altar. As soon as his hand touched Nityananda, he went flying back at least 7 paces. Unperturbed, Nityananda Prabhu lifted the flower garland from Lord Balaram's neck and slipped it on his own neck. He got down and walked away majestically, like the king of the elephants. The sentry, still bewildered, quickly got up. He thought, "This sannyasi is certainly endowed with superhuman powers. Otherwise, he could not go away unpunished after touching Lord Balaram. I have the strength to check a mad elephant, and certainly no human being can escape me. Yet, although I definitely had him in a strong grip, I found myself blown away like dry grass." The next time he saw Lord Nityananda, he approached him with great humility. Lord Nityananda's character is like that of an innocent child. He immediately forgave the sentry and embraced him. A few days later, Lord Gaurachandra, the husband of Lakshmi Devi, the goddess of fortune, went to live near the ocean. The beach and surrounding area were idyllic, and this pleased the Lord. The moon had set the night aglow with her soft aura. The southern breeze caressed the Lord as he sat on the seashore. His body and beatific face were exquisitely decorated with sandalwood paste. A lovely flower garland nearly covered his broad chest. He continuously chanted the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. He was a picture of perfect beauty. The devotees sitting around him enjoyed his every movement. The waves approached swiftly, approaching in uneven white lines, foaming as they crested one after another. The Lord smiled as he watched the endless swells of churning water. The benedictions already received from the Supreme Lord by Ganga Devi and Yamuna Devi were now being showered upon the ocean. The Lord spent that whole night performing kirtan in divine bliss. He was immersed in a nectarian ocean of his own loving mellows and danced vigorously, drowning his devotees in the flood of ecstasy. The different ecstatic symptoms like horripilation, crying, shivering, roaring, and perspiring sometimes came in waves, one after the other, and at other times occurred all at once. All the different devotional ecstasies bloomed like various seasonal flowers on the Lord's body. This was possible only by the Lord's inconceivable potency. The devotees gathered around him as he danced, saturated in the mood of a Vaishnav. The Lord felt happy in the company of his devotees and forgot the pangs of loving separation from his Lord. The Supreme Lord utilizes only a small fraction of his unlimited potencies to perform his pastimes, but still it is impossible for anyone to imitate them. The Vedic scriptures unequivocally state that no task is too difficult for the Lord. The ecstatic devotional symptoms of love of Godhead exhibited by Lord Chaitanya cannot be displayed by anyone else. The glories of Lord Chaitanya are unlimited. Only those who are blessed with his mercy are able to comprehend him with all his potencies. Therefore, all the knots of material entanglement can be easily severed by taking full shelter of the Supreme Lord. That Supreme Personality who is constantly meditated on by perfected beings like Lord Shiva, Lord Brahma, and so on, was now dancing freely with his devotees, swept away in the currents of his own devotional ecstasy. I fall at the feet of those devotees who performed Sankirtan with the Lord. All-night kirtans on the seashore became more and more frequent, and the Lord participated in them with ecstatic dancing. It was at this time that Gadadhar Pandit began to spend practically all his time with the Lord. They ate together, slept together, and went on walks together. Gadadhar Pandit served Lord Chaitanya continuously. When he read aloud to the Lord from the Srimad Bhagavatam, the Lord entered a state of blissful trance. Gadadhar Pandit's voice always made him happy, and he would accompany the Lord to visit various Vaishnavas. One day, the Lord went to Sri Paramananda Puri's mat, where he sat down close to him. Sri Paramananda Puri was very dear to the Lord, just as Arjuna had been very dear to Krishna. They became totally absorbed in confidential discussions of Lord Krishna's pastimes. They spent a long time together. There was a well in that mat, the water from which was not clean or drinkable. Lord Chaitanya, as the Supersoul, knew about this well, so he inquired from Puri Goswami, "Please tell me how you find the well water." Puri Goswami replied, "This is an unfortunate well. Its water is very muddy." The Lord showed immediate concern, lamenting over this inconvenience to Puri Goswami. He said, "It seems that Lord Jagannath is being very miserly. Actually, whoever touches the water of this well is cleansed of all sins. Therefore, by Lord Jagannath's mystic potency, the water has turned muddy, so no one will drink or touch it." The Lord stood up, and raising his hands in the air, he began to speak, "O Lord Jagannath, I beg this benediction from you, that Mother Ganga may enter this well. Please instruct Ganga Devi, who is now flowing in the nether regions, to appear here." The devotees became extremely jubilant, chanting, "Hari, Hari." The Lord returned home that night with all of them. While the devotees slept, Ganga Devi, feeling honored to carry out the Lord's order, appeared in that well. In the morning, everyone saw the miracle. The well water had turned crystal clear. The devotees marveled and chanted the Lord's holy name. Sri Puri Goswami became almost unconscious with joy. The devotees, understanding that Ganga Devi had entered the well, began to circumambulate it. When Mahaprabhu heard the news, he came and upon seeing the fresh clean water, was very content. He said to his devotees, "Whoever drinks this water or bathes in it will experience unalloyed devotion to Lord Krishna." The devotees responded jubilantly to the Lord's words. The Lord then bathed in and drank water from the well with great exhilaration. He said, "I remain in this world only because I am bound by Sri Puri Goswami's love. I am his property. If he wants to sell me, then he can do so." Anyone who simply sees Puri Goswami develops love for Lord Krishna. After describing the extraordinary qualities of Sri Puri Goswami and blessing the well, the Lord left for his residence. the Supreme Lord takes shelter in lauding the transcendental qualities of his devotees. Who is so mean and despicable that he will not worship such a person? The Lord appears to protect his devotees and to perform wonderful pastimes in their association. He even does things for his devotees which are generally considered wrong, as when Lord Ram killed Bali in support of Sugriva, his devotee. The Lord gladly serves his servitors. In this way, Lord Chaitanya won the hearts of his devotees. The Lord liked to perform Sankirtan on the shore of the ocean. He built his residence near the beach and stayed there swimming in the ocean of devotional bliss. The ocean experienced indescribable ecstasy having the Lord's close association. Hence Rama, Lakshmi Devi, was born from it. The residents of Nilachala were completely cleansed of all sins simply by bathing in the ocean. Ganga Devi, taking advantage of this golden opportunity, flowed swiftly to merge into the ocean. Sri Krishna Chaitanya's presence blessed the ocean and purified its waters. When Lord Chaitanya had come to Nilachala, King Prataparudra was away waging war against the southern kingdom of Vijayanagar. After a long sojourn in Nilachala, Lord Chaitanya returned to Bengal. It was because the Lord felt especially merciful towards Ganga Devi that he went there. Sri Vidya Vachaspati was Sarvabhauma's brother. He was gentle, charitable, and saintly. One day, Lord Chaitanya arrived at his residence with all his servitors without prior notification. Seeing that his guest was none other than the Lord of Vaikuntha, Lord Gaurasundar, Vidya Vachaspati fell like a rod at his lotus feet. The Brahmin host was so confused with extreme joy that he did not know what was the proper thing to do next. Happy to see the saintly Brahmin, the Lord embraced him and said, "I have a request to make of you. My heart is set on going to Mathura, Vrindavan, but first I want to spend a few days here to bathe in the Ganga. Please find me a quiet bathing spot where I will not be disturbed by crowds. After that, I want you to help me start my journey to Braja. If you want me to remain here, then you must make these arrangements." Sri Vidya Vachaspati attentively heard everything the Lord said. He replied with great humility, "Simply by receiving the dust from your lotus feet and having you in my house, I have brought great fortune to my family and race. My house and everything else belong to you, my Lord. Kindly remain here comfortably. I will see that no one knows you are here." Content to hear these humble and sincere words, the Lord stayed there for a few days. But just as the sun cannot be hidden, the Lord's arrival immediately became known. Word spread like wildfire that Lord Chaitanya, the shining jewel of the sannyas order, was residing in the house of Sri Vidya Vachaspati. The people experienced great exhilaration. They felt that they were in Vaikuntha, even though they were still in their material bodies. They jubilantly chanted Hari Hari, forgetting their wives, sons, wealth, homes, and everything else. The people became very excited and began to talk animatedly amongst themselves. They said, "Let us go and be blessed by the sight of his lotus feet." In their enthusiasm, they almost forgot all etiquette. A huge crowd moved toward Vidya Vachaspati's house, loudly chanting Hari Hari. All the regular paths and roads were full, so people went off in all directions, trampling plants and bushes. Please listen attentively as I continue to describe Lord Chaitanya's extraordinary influence by which he will liberate all living entities. Undeterred by the thorny bushes, people happily went to see the Lord. Wild, woody areas were cleared by the moving mass of people and made into makeshift pathways. All of them had only the holy names of God on their tongues. The people were expectant and talked amongst themselves. One said, "I will fall at his feet and beg him to give me the benediction that all my material entanglements be severed." Another said, "If I can see him just once with these eyes, I will consider that I have received everything obtainable. Why then should I ask anything more from him?" Yet another said, "I was hopelessly ignorant about his real position and potencies. Therefore, for so long, I have only criticized him in a very offensive manner. Now I will clasp his lotus feet to my heart and beg him to tell me how I can atone for all my offenses." A fatherly man said, "My son is a compulsive gambler, and I will beg the Lord to make him stop." Someone else said, "The only boon I want is that my body, mind, and words may always remain fixed at his lotus feet." Another commented, What a wonderful opportunity this is. I pray only that I may never forget my dear Lord Gaurasundar. Talking in this manner, they moved in a massive column, all of them feeling indescribable bliss. The milling crowd converged on the ferry port, everyone wanting to be the first to cross the river. The boatmen were put into extreme anxiety as they saw the uncontrollable crowd piling into the larger boats. Hundreds tried to pack into each boat. Finally, the boats began to collapse under the excessive weight. The people then gave their clothes to the boatmen as some compensation for their loss, and with unrestrained joy, continued their endeavors to cross the river. They became innovative in the absence of boats and used any available means to cross. Some tied upturned earthen pots around their chests to float across. Others made rafts out of banana tree trunks and drifted across. Those who could swim had great fun swimming in the currents. The tumultuous chanting of Hari Hari pierced the outer covering of the material universe. Vidya Vachaspati came running in search of large boats and collected many, but the impatient crowd refused to wait and crossed over any way they could. Only the Supreme Personality can attract the minds of people the way Lord Chaitanya was now doing. Having crossed over the Ganga, the people went directly to Vidya Vachaspati and fell at his feet. They said, "You are very saintly and fortunate because the Supreme Lord Chaitanya is a guest in your house. Your good luck cannot be described. Kindly save us. We are most sinful persons who have fallen into the dark well of material existence. Kindly lead us to Lord Gauranga and show us his lotus feet so that our wretched lives may become successful." Sri Vidya Vachaspati was extremely moved to see the sincerity of the people and began to weep with joy. He led the thousands of people who were gathered there to his residence. The only sound was the chanting of the Lord's name. Lord Gaurasundar is an ocean of compassion, and he appeared especially to liberate all living entities. When he heard the tumultuous chanting of the holy names of God, he came out of the house to bless the fortunate souls and increase their pleasure. He appeared before them as an enchanting figure of unparalleled beauty. His effulgent face was decorated with a gentle smile, and his eyes shone with transcendental joy. His golden body was decorated with sandalwood paste and tilak markings. A lovely flower garland adorned his chest. His gait was as graceful as that of an elephant. He raised his long, exquisite arms and chanted Hari, Hari in a voice like thunder. When the people saw Lord Gaurasundar, they jumped and danced in great exultation, chanting loudly and then falling to the ground like sticks, offering obeisances. Rising like ocean waves, they lifted their arms to the sky and prayed, "O Lord, please save us, sinners." The Lord smiled benevolently and blessed them, saying, "May all you develop love for Lord Krishna. Chant Krishna's name, worship him, and hear about his pastimes. Make Lord Krishna the greatest treasure of your lives." The people were happy beyond words to receive such benedictions. They repeatedly praised the Lord and pleaded, "Your advent in this world is a secret. You have appeared from the womb of Mother Sachi and Navadweep just to liberate the whole universe. But we are so sinful that we could not recognize you and remained in the deep dark well of ignorance, spoiling our human lives. O Lord, you are an ocean of mercy and the benefactor of all living entities. Benedict us that we may never forget you." These ordinary people were able to speak eloquently only by the potency of Lord Gaurachandra. The village became overrun with people. There was no free space. People climbed onto roofs and onto the tops of trees. Their eagerness to see the Lord increased every moment. The extraordinary thing was that although the trees and roofs were full of people, no roofs collapsed and no trees fell down. This was possible by the transcendental potency of the Lord. Everyone's eyes remained fixed on his perfect and beautiful face. Having seen him, they had no desire to return home. They chanted jubilantly and relished the captivating beauty of the Lord. The Supreme Lord Gaurasundar is the master of all mystic potencies. Hence, he was able to leave Sri Vidya Vachaspati's residence without his knowledge and go to the village of Kulia. The people also did not see him leave. Only Nityananda and a few other associates accompanied him. Meanwhile, Sri Vachaspati began to frantically look everywhere for the Lord. Not finding him, he concluded that the Lord must have left. Grief-stricken, he lifted his face to the heavens and began to weep bitterly. The people outside, noticing the Lord's absence, were convinced that he must have gone inside to avoid the commotion. The crowd of thousands began to chant loudly, filling the universe with the holy names. His mind, paralyzed with grief, Sri Vidya Vachaspati came out and broke the sad news of the Lord's departure to the people. He said, "I do not even know at what time in the night he left or where he went. The crest jewel of the sannyas order, our beloved Lord, has deluded us, a most sinful lot, and gone." My dear brothers, I tell you truthfully that I do not know his destination. Sri Vachaspati tried with many words to convince them of the truth, but he could not win their trust. Continuing to think that the Lord was hiding to avoid the crowd, they waited expectantly. People came up to Sri Vachaspati and requested, "Please take me inside to see the Lord. I promise you that I am alone." They grabbed his feet and entreated him, "We want to see the Lord just once with these eyes, then we can return home happily. Please place this prayer before the Lord so that sinners like us may also see him. He will not refuse you." Vachaspati patiently tried to tell them the truth, but failed to convince them of his sincerity. After some time, realizing that the Lord was not coming out, the people became impatient and frustrated. They spoke cutting words to Vachaspati. Someone said, "Vachaspati has hidden that rarest gem amongst sannyasis, our Lord Chaitanya, and now he is coming and telling us lies. Why should he feel sorry if we are liberated? What joy is there in saving oneself alone?" Another person complained, "A good person is satisfied when others are liberated. An ordinary soul simply thinks selfishly of his own betterment, but a saintly soul sees to the salvation of others before he considers himself." Yet another person said, "Even in ordinary social dealings, it is considered offensive to buy sweets and eat them oneself without sharing them with others." Someone else said, "This Brahmin is crooked in his behavior. He is not inclined to help others." Not only was Vachaspati greatly afflicted by the Lord's departure, but he was also extremely distressed by the accusations hurled at him by the people. He saw no solution to his dilemma. Suddenly, a Brahmin came and spoke softly into Vachaspati's ear. "Lord Chaitanya has gone to the village of Kulia. Do what you want with this information immediately." The clouds of gloom dissipated and Vachaspati was happy again. He warmly embraced the Brahmin. Vachaspati rushed out to the crowd and told them the news. He said, "Not knowing the actual facts, all of you have been falsely accusing me of hiding the Lord in my house. I have just received the information from a Brahmin that the Lord is in the village of Kulia. Let us go and find out if this information is correct. If it is, then you must agree that I am an honest, upright Brahmin." Expressing their appreciation by chanting Hari Hari, the people immediately left for Kulia, their hearts bubbling with joy. The word spread quickly that the most exalted of sannyasis, Lord Chaitanya, was in Kulia. Meanwhile, the crowd had multiplied several times over. Only Ganga Devi separated them from Kulia. It seemed that Kulia had more magnetism than Vachaspati's village. The crowd had swelled to millions. Only Ananta Shesh could describe this extraordinary phenomenon. No one could say from where this multitude of people had magically appeared. Although many boats capsized, there was no loss of life, and everyone somehow crossed the Ganga. The miraculous thing was that each time a boat was on the verge of capsizing, land appeared below it and prevented the calamity. This happened by the desire of Lord Chaitanya. Whoever sings the glories of this Supreme Personality can easily cross over the material ocean, as if it were as small as the hoofprint of a calf. It is not surprising that those who were eager to see the Lord could cross Ganga Devi without any accidents. Thousands of people crossed the river on their own, drowning in an ocean of joy. Once on the other side, they embraced each other, loudly chanting the Lord's holy name. It was a big day for making money. No one could calculate how much the boatmen earned. Makeshift markets selling a variety of wares suddenly appeared everywhere and did thriving business. Gradually, every space was filled and the whole town became an ocean of people. Above the din of mundane activities rose the loud chanting of God's names. In spite of this tumult, the Lord remained in seclusion. When Sri Vidya Vachaspati arrived in Kulia, he began searching for the Lord, but as the Lord had refused to show himself in public, it was difficult to locate him. After a frantic search, Sri Vachaspati finally discovered him. As soon as he saw the Lord, he fell to the ground like a stick and offered obeisances to him. Vachaspati began reciting verses describing the Lord's present incarnation and pastimes. He prayed, O Lord, you have appeared as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, just to liberate the whole universe. You have already liberated those who have fallen into this deep dark well of material existence. Your mercy is as vast as the unlimited ocean, so kindly let this mercy touch my heart eternally. Seeing the entire creation steeped in mundane activities, you have showered your causeless mercy upon the living entities, giving them love of Godhead. May you, the most magnanimous Supreme Personality, always reside in the core of my heart. Glorifying Lord Gaurasundara in this manner, he again fell at his feet. I offer my humble respects at the feet of Visharad, the father of the illustrious Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Vidya Vachaspati. Vachaspati looked up at his dear Lord, and exhilarated by his merciful glance, he began to speak again. He stood up and prayed with folded hands. O merciful Lord, I have only one prayer. You are the supreme autocrat, fully independent, acting according to your own sweet will. Others can know your mind only as much as you reveal it to them. You are not bound by rules and regulations imposed by anyone else. The people outside, not understanding this simple truth about you, have accused me of hiding you in my house. Unaware of the actual facts, they are angry at me. Therefore, my Lord, kindly step outside for a moment and show yourself. Then they will once again accept me as a truthful Brahmin. Hearing his words, the Lord smiled and immediately complied with his request. As soon as he stepped outside, the people were drowned in an ocean of bliss. They threw themselves to the ground, offering their obeisances. Each one, according to his knowledge and capacity, began reciting verses eulogizing the Lord. Their joy gradually increased, and hundreds of kirtan groups sprung up everywhere and began to sing sweetly. The holy name of Krishna resounded melodiously in the heavens. This happened by the extraordinary potency of Lord Chaitanya. The Supreme Lord, now dressed as a sannyasi, initiated the congregational chanting of the holy name of Krishna. That name is so sublime that it gives one the taste of divine nectar. The higher planets like Brahmaloka and Shivaloka are freed from all distress simply by receiving a mere drop of that nectar. The great mystic yogis and sages are mad after a drop of it. Anyone who, in gross illusion, refutes the existence of such a supreme personality, who is endowed with all potencies and opulences, loses all good qualities and status in society, and is shunned by everyone. Therefore, simply worship the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya. Ignorance is destroyed by hearing his pastimes. By remembering him and his transcendental activities, all sins are eradicated. The Lord became ecstatic seeing kirtan being performed everywhere. Tears cascaded down his cheeks as if Ganga Devi had manifested in his eyes. He became absorbed in the congregational chanting. He joined whichever kirtan group was in front and danced with sublime joy. This increased the enthusiasm and bliss of that group, and they considered themselves most fortunate to be blessed by the Lord in this way. Lord Nityananda, who is foremost amongst the devotees who are mad with love for God, sometimes caught Lord Chaitanya and made him dance. Sometimes he danced along with the Lord, lost in the ecstasy of spiritual love. Lord Chaitanya now danced with full abandon, roaring loudly with ecstasy. Such is the potency of the holy name that all despondency is dissipated on hearing it. Lord Shiva becomes so intoxicated when he dances meditating on Lord Gauranga that he is not even aware that he is naked. Now even mere mortals could see the Supreme Lord Gauranga dancing before them. The whole cosmic manifestation is created by his potency, and the demigods are always eager to serve him directly. Now the entire universe was liberated by his advent, and all the people were drowned in waves of divine bliss. The Lord was unaware of the crowd which poured in from all directions to see him. He was totally absorbed in love of Godhead and danced ecstatically. Everyone in the town of Kulia was liberated by the Lord's presence. From the most elevated soul to the most fallen soul, all receive the Lord's mercy. Whoever hears this narration will also become free from the shackles of karmic reactions. The compassionate Lord stayed outside long enough for everyone to see him, raising their consciousness to a state of intense joy. He then went inside, accompanied by his associates, and sat down, enjoying their company. Just then a Brahmin came and clasped the Lord's feet tightly. He said, "O Lord, I have just one prayer. Please spare a little time to hear me. Not understanding the essence of devotional service, I have committed a grievous offense by criticizing the Vaishnavs. I would repeatedly shout and taunt, 'Who is a Vaishnav in Kali Yuga, and what is this kirtan?' In this way, I have condemned myself. When I remember these incidents, my mind burns. O Lord, you have the potency to liberate anyone. So kindly tell me how I can atone for my sins." Lord Chaitanya smiled benignly on hearing the Brahmin's straightforward confession. He said, "O Brahmin, if one who has taken poison is administered nectar, the drink of immortality, then gradually the effects of poison weaken and the body becomes immortal. Now I will tell you how this nectar works. Your criticizing the Vaishnavas was equivalent to drinking poison. So now you must drink the nectar of Krishna's name and pastimes with that same mouth. From now on, use the tongue that offended Vaishnavas to glorify them. Above all other activities, constantly glorify them through songs, poems, and all other means possible. The ambrosia of Krishna's pastimes is transcendentally blissful and can easily counteract the poisonous effects of criticizing Vaishnavas. This is the method of purification for one who unknowingly criticizes a Vaishnav. If one gives up his offensive behavior and constantly glorifies the Supreme Lord and his unalloyed devotees, he can destroy all sins. Otherwise, millions of pious activities and penances cannot counteract the offenses committed against a Vaishnav. So go now and practice glorifying the devotees of the Lord. In this way, you will become free from all sins." The devotees became very happy to hear these wonderful instructions, and they responded by chanting Hari, Hari. One who disregards these instructions of Lord Chaitanya and criticizes a saintly person must drown in the ocean of grief. Those who accept his instructions as Vedic truth can smilingly cross the ocean of nescience. The next visitor was Devananda Pandit. He was a resident of Navadvip. When Lord Chaitanya had been engaged in family life in Navadvip, where he performed many transcendental pastimes, Devananda Pandit had not had the desire to meet him. Not possessing sufficient faith in the Lord, he had avoided coming in contact with him. Although qualified by sufficient piety, for some reason he did not meet the Lord at this time. This was actually the arrangement of Krishna. After Lord Chaitanya took sannyas and left home, Devananda Pandit had the good fortune to closely associate with Vakreshwar Pandit. Vakreshwar Pandit was very dear to Lord Chaitanya. He was such an elevated soul that he could purify the entire universe. He was always totally absorbed in relishing devotional mellows with Lord Krishna. When he danced, both the demigods and the demons were captivated. In fact, by Lord Chaitanya's mercy, as soon as he would begin to dance, he would manifest all the ecstatic symptoms like crying, shivering, perspiring, laughing, horripilation, roaring, and swooning in divine bliss. It is impossible to describe all the devotional symptoms displayed by Vakreshwar Pandit. By the arrangement of Providence, he went to stay in the house of Devananda Pandit, attracted by his devotional qualities. Devananda Pandit was very impressed with Vakreshwar Pandit's radiant appearance and his unalloyed devotion to the Supreme Lord. He began to serve him with sincere devotion. When Vakreshwar Pandit would dance, he would walk around him with a cane, keeping the crowd from disturbing him. When Vakreshwar would swoon in ecstasy, Devananda Pandit would rush to catch him in his arms. He would take the dust from Vakreshwar's body and feet and smear it all over his own body with humility and devotion. In this way, by serving him and seeing his elevated devotional characteristics, Devananda Pandit developed strong faith in Lord Chaitanya. This incident illustrates the statement in the Puranas that devotion to the Supreme Lord is developed only through serving the pure devotees of the Lord. Devananda Pandit was a very pious and noble person. From his childhood, he had studied the Srimad Bhagavatam. He was calm and peaceful, in control of his senses, unattached to material things, and endowed with many other good qualities. However, in spite of these qualities, he could not develop attraction to Lord Chaitanya's lotus feet. It was only by the mercy of Vakreshwar that his perverted intelligence became rectified. It is stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam that service to a pure devotee is even higher than service to the Supreme Lord himself. There may exist some doubt about the success in attaining perfection by serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but there is absolutely no doubt whatever in achieving perfection by serving the pure devotees of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, it is clear that to gain the mercy of Lord Krishna, one must serve his unalloyed devotee. Devananda Pandit developed devotional attachment to Lord Gauranga due to his intimate association with Vakreshwar Pandit. Now he lay on the ground, clasping the Lord's lotus feet in great awe and humility. The Lord was very pleased to see Devananda Pandit's devotional mood. He reached out to him and made him sit up. In this way, he forgave all his previous offenses and blessed him. The Lord said, "Because you have served Vakreshwar Pandit so well, you are able to see me here today." Vakreshwar is a manifestation of Krishna's transcendental potency. Hence, whoever serves him will immediately attain the lotus feet of Krishna. Lord Krishna's favorite residence is the heart of Vakreshwar Pandit. When he dances, Krishna himself is induced to dance. His presence converts any place into a holy place of pilgrimage, into the spiritual abode of Krishna, Vaikuntha. The Brahmin, Devananda Pandit, folded his hands and prayed to the Lord. O Lord, out of your infinite compassion, you appeared in Navadvip solely for the purpose of delivering all of humanity. I am so sinful that at that time I could not even see you, nor could I experience the divine bliss of your association. You shower benedictions on all living beings. Hence I pray that I may develop attachment to your lotus feet. I have one special favor to ask of you. I need your divine guidance. I have no knowledge, yet I am trying to teach from the supreme book of knowledge, the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is meant to be taught only by realized souls. O Lord, please instruct me what to teach and how to explain the Bhagavat. The Lord began to explain the essence of the Srimad Bhagavatam. O learned Brahman, interpret the Bhagavatam only in the light of bhakti, or devotion. Do not describe any other process. In the beginning, middle, and end, the Bhagavatam establishes that devotional service to the Supreme Lord is eternal, absolute, and infallible. Devotional service is the only reality, the absolute truth. At the time of total dissolution of this cosmic creation, when everything else is annihilated, only this reality remains unaffected and perfect. The Supreme Lord Krishna does not award devotional service to everyone. He easily offers liberation to an aspirant, but he hides the science of unalloyed devotion. Only through his mercy does he elevate someone to the path of bhakti. The philosophical conclusions on the path of bhakti available in the Srimad Bhagavatam have no parallel in any other scripture. Just as all the incarnations of the Lord, like Matsya, Karma, and so on, are self-manifest and appear and disappear at will, similarly, the Srimad Bhagavatam is not a scripture composed by ordinary mortals. It is transcendental. Hence, it also appears and disappears by God's will. The Bhagavatam, having disappeared, has once again appeared on the tongue of Srila Veda Vyas by the causeless mercy of Lord Krishna. The esoteric truth about the Supreme Lord is inconceivable, as is the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the verdict of all the scriptures. One who claims to know and understand the Srimad Bhagavatam is certainly ignorant about its real conclusions. On the other hand, if one is submissive and admits his lack of understanding, then the essence of the Bhagavatam will indeed be revealed to him. The Bhagavatam is saturated with divine love of Godhead. It is in fact the body of Lord Krishna. It contains his confidential pastimes. After having compiled the many different Puranas and Vedas, Srila Veda Vyas was still feeling a vacuum in himself, but when he finally spoke the Bhagavatam, he became completely satisfied. But sometimes one might become confused by reading this great scripture, so be very careful. The only way to explain the Bhagavatam is through bhakti. In this way you can atone for all your offenses and experience sublime bliss in your heart. All scriptures conclude that devotion to Lord Krishna is the ultimate goal of life. The Bhagavatam is special because it is imbued with the supramundane exchanges of mellows with Krishna. Now return and study the Bhagavatam well and explain to everyone that devotional service to Krishna is the highest ambrosia. Devananda Pandit fell flat on the ground at the Lord's lotus feet, thinking himself the most fortunate soul. After surrendering his body, mind, and words to the Lord, and offering repeated obeisances, he returned to his home. Lord Gaurasundar instructed everyone about the actual position of the Srimad Bhagavatam, which teaches nothing but bhakti. One who does not explain the path of devotional service while teaching the Bhagavatam wastes his energy and words and reaps the fruits of his offenses. One who understands that the Srimad Bhagavatam is a treatise dedicated fully to the science of devotional service becomes a recipient of Lord Krishna's special mercy. The presence of the Bhagavatam in any house sanctifies it and frees it from all inauspiciousness. Worshipping the Bhagavatam is equivalent to worshipping Lord Krishna. Hearing and reading the Bhagavatam is unalloyed devotional service. There are two meanings of the word Bhagavat. One is the book, Srimad Bhagavatam, and the other is the person, Bhagavat, who is the personification of Lord Krishna's mercy. By daily worshipping, studying, and hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam, one actually becomes a person, Bhagavat. On the other hand, a sinful person who reads the Srimad Bhagavatam without the proper attitude will criticize Lord Nityananda due to a lack of proper understanding. Lord Nityananda is the embodiment of the essence and divine mellows of the Srimad Bhagavatam. One who understands this is truly an intelligent and fortunate soul. As Ananta Shesh, Lord Nityananda is continuously explaining the purports of the Bhagavatam with his thousands of mouths. Although Lord Nityananda is unlimited, he is not able to fully complete his dissertation on the Bhagavatam. The Srimad Bhagavatam is transcendental and unlimited, and its conclusion is the path of bhakti. The Lord taught everyone the real essence of the Srimad Bhagavatam by means of his discussion with Devananda Pandit. He answered everyone's spiritual questions to their full satisfaction. By going to Kulia, Lord Sri Krishna Chaitanya blessed all its residents. Everyone there was fully satiated by looking at him. In this way, he fulfilled everyone's desires and alleviated all their distress and despondency. One who hears these pastimes with pleasure will certainly associate with the Lord directly. No matter which family a person may be born into, his life is auspicious if he hears the transcendental topics of Lord Krishna's pastimes. Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda are my life and soul. I, Vrindavan Das, humbly offer this song at their lotus feet.